All right, thanks, Josh. And another thank you to Sikasa for inviting me. I'm super excited. So let's get into it. Seeing the title, hopefully that's why you're here today. My name is Christy Kumar. I'm the Assistant Director of Educational Programs at the Women and Gender Advocacy Center. So we have an hour together. My goal is to fly through just the basic social-ecological framing and disrupting teen violence in 40 minutes, and then some time for questions. But like Josh said, please get those questions going, and we'll definitely get to it somewhat throughout the presentation. So I wanted to start off a little bit about putting a face to who you're listening to, because throughout this presentation, I'm going to be talking about systems of oppression, of dominance, of identity, and saying that those matter, those identities matter, and that lived experience matters. So there you see a little bit about my life and kind of like my educational background, some of the privileges I hold, constantly thinking about my next meal, which I will be doing after this, and then some lenses, methods, and praxis. Don't really have the time to get into all of those different ones, but those are the ones that I definitely center in not only my professional work, but my scholarly work, personal work, and activism, right? And so you'll see in there, we've got decolonial feminisms, radical honesty, utilizing counter narratives, not just sticking with, well, tell me what are the facts, what's the data, right? And knowing that we have to root these conversations, particularly around violence, around stories and storytelling. So themes that we're going to explore today is the SEM model, interpersonal violence, so that includes sexual assault and teen dating violence, rape supportive culture, culture of consent, and some anti-violence strategies that we use at the Women and Gender Advocacy Center here at Colorado State University. So for folks who are, I'm going to do kind of a brief overview of this. So it's definitely something that the interwebs will tell you more about. But it's a model proposed by Yuri Bronfenbrenner. And basically, he postulated that in order to understand human development, the entire ecological system in which growth occurs needs to be taken into account. And you see this model being used by anti-violence activists, educators, because it's pretty holistic. And so what I want to do is break down each of the levels with you here. I like to start when I'm doing this by starting from the top and starting with societal. And the way that I ask folks to think about this, this is like the worldview. And I know that that kind of, we have to think about like geopolitical spaces, boundaries, locations. So I'm going to be using, I'm going to be speaking from a pretty Western centric framework for today. It's basically the air we breathe. So, and kind of it's how culture exists. So in this societal level, you're definitely going to get patriarchy, right? You're going to get submissive femininity, dominant and toxic masculinities. And then we move through to institutional. You can also think of this as like community. So these are the values and policies within academic institutions, religious groups, professional workplaces, law enforcement, healthcare, and ways that actually we can create barriers through actual policies that hinder support, services, or justice. Then we move down to the interpersonal. You can also think of this as relationships. These are attitudes and beliefs that we hold within close relationships, such as social peers, classmates, family, intimate partners, and oftentimes these tolerate and justify sexual aggression, even at this interpersonal level. And then we go all the way down to the individual, which is the protective or risk factors in an individual's personal history and socialization that increase the possibility of experiencing or perpetrating sexual violence. So on that individual level, it's important to think about internalized and forms of dominance and internalized forms of oppression. Right, and so I know that was pretty conceptual, so I want to go through this using actual examples. So let's start with a societal construct. I have all these listed right now, and they're what encompass rape supportive culture. So when not just young folks, right, but society talks about sex by saying, hit that, smash that, why didn't she leave? And even something perhaps a little bit more insidious, like no means no, right? And so that would be like a societal framing around really dating, relationships, sex. And then you go into the institutional level where we don't talk about consent education from an institutional perspective. So I wanted to talk about this interesting concept that in the US, we do prioritize educating kids on safety. We just don't talk about safety within the realm of sexuality. So in any given year, around like 3% of school U.S. school-age kids will encounter a fire at school, but the odds of being injured by that fire are like virtually zero. But we definitely teach students fire safety every year starting in kindergarten. I did a presentation just yesterday with a multicultural sorority. I asked them to raise their hands. How many folks got fire safety education in their schools? 100% raised their hands. Then I asked them, how many of you were taught consent? Zero of them raised their hands. So it's just the way that that cultural, societal worldview, what we value, then gets placed down into the institutional. What do we actually put money behind teaching folks? So, you know, 19 states require sex educators to teach that sex should only happen after marriage, and only 24 states in Washington, D.C. mandate that schools teach any kind of sex ed at all. And only one, California, mandates that students receive education and affirmative consent. So that would be examples of the institutional values. Then we move on to interpersonal. So the consequences of interpersonal violence are devastating, right? We know that, I think there's a 2017 CDC report said that approximately 7% of women and 4% of men, this is binary statistics, who have ever experienced rape, physical violence, or stalking by an intimate partner, experienced some form of partner violence by that partner before 18 years of age. And those statistics are pretty pretty solid for us here at the Women Gender Advocacy Center. We work with college-age students, but we know that the majority of folks that have experienced interpersonal violence have experienced that before they were 18. I have here, this is what love looks like, right? So when it's gone from the social to the institutional, all the way to the interpersonal aspect, there's kind of this idea that like, hey, maybe this is what I've seen in my family. This is what my friends are talking about. This is what the music is saying. So this must be what love has to look like, right? And then we go all the way down to the individual level, right? And so we get to the spot where it's, I deserve this. And I chose that phrase because it could kind of, there's like a duality to that phrase, I deserve this. There's the concept that certain folks with dominant identities, privileged identities, will say, you know, I deserve access to bodies, right? I deserve to kiss this person. I deserve to call you my girlfriend, right? And then there's also the internalized oppressive sense of that, which is, maybe I did something to be in this type of relationship, right? Like if all those levels have been at play, oftentimes it'll go to the internal psyche. And so now that I've gone through very quickly the social ecological model, what I want to talk about is that ultimately when we're talking about disrupting, dismantling violence, We oftentimes stay on this individual level where we're like, let's talk to students. Let's say you don't deserve this. Let's say everyone deserves to be treated equally, right? And from my perspective, that's a very short-sighted way to address violence because we're not taking in the micro, the macro, and the meso at the same time. Obviously, that's a much harder way to do this work, right? And we can't do it at once. So that's why this perspective comes from kind of like a community organizing perspective. We need to be tackling all four levels simultaneously to create some sort of shift in culture that flows all the way down to self-worth and to what some might call empowerment. So I'm going to go through some definitions rather quickly because I figure if you've got the savviness to be on a webinar, you for sure can seek definitions from other sources than just me. I don't want to claim that I have the most expert definitions of these constructs. So just going through them quickly, at the WGAC, we definitely talk about interpersonal violence as an umbrella term. I do think it's important that we differentiate rape, sexual assault, relationship violence, sexual harassment, and stalking, but not enough insofar as one becomes more important than the other, right? We're not trying to create hierarchies where we're only focusing on one aspect of rape or sexual assault, right? And knowing that these very much so interact with identities, particularly dominant and subordinate identities, right? So the way that interpersonal violence, we know that trans, gender non-binary, gender queer folks, and folks of color experience these types of violences at much higher rates than cis white folks, right? So I wanna make sure that we're understanding those intersections. Here I have sexual assault, kind of bolded the important concepts here, that any sexual contact without consent is based on power and control, and it's not your fault. And so when we're talking with survivors, making sure that we're not engaging in any kind of victim blaming when we're asking, what were you wearing? Why were you there? Like, who said that would be a good idea? And that really a trauma and survivor-centered approach is first and foremost, I believe you, and this is not your fault. So, teen dating violence. I have some statistics here, and it says that nearly 1.5 million high school students in the U.S. are physically abused by dating partners every year. This is work that I got off of Melinda D. Anderson out of Atlantic. And more than one-third of 10th graders have been physically or verbally abused by dating partners. This part is for those of you who are like, all right, listen, this is enough ethnic studies and sociology. I want to know data. I want to talk about peer-reviewed research. So I'm going to give a little quick about a study that just came out of a peer-reviewed journal, Violence and Gender. I've got the title there, and you're going to get this PowerPoint. So if you want to look more into it, or if you're like, yeah, I want to look through that and kind of critique it, and you have any feedback for me, please let me know. For the study, researchers surveyed a nationally representative high school principals, right? And so there was a questionnaire. It was sent out to like 750 randomly selected principals. And what they found in this survey was pretty striking. Basically, it says that a majority of high school principals had assisted a teen dating violence victim in the past 2 years. And then more than two-thirds of respondents said that they lacked the formal training, and a majority reported that the teachers and staff in their school hadn't been recently trained. So this is kind of back to that societal perspective, right? Like, we know kids are ready to know what to do. They have been trained in case this fire is coming. 3%, right, will be facing that fire, yet we know the rates of sexualized violence are staggering, yet we are not training the folks who are going to be utilizing that institutional level of the model to do that work. And so the study also talked about that when principals were presented with several options and asked to identify the largest barrier to assisting student victims, the second most common response following lack of training was that dating violence is a minor issue compared with other student health issues. And so there's a lot of misinformation here. Folks said that principals and folks were most likely to assume that counselors and parents were preferable to student peers in assisting victims. So I want you to keep that finding in mind as we continue, that this preference to counselors and parents that principals are thinking as opposed to student peers. Only 36% of principals included in the study believe that students have a major role in assisting survivors. So that was my quick ode to a case study. I want to talk about, for the folks that are like, okay, I get it, it's a problem, it's deep, what are we going to do about it? So I've kind of laid out some common, there's more on the next page, don't worry, these are not the only two, anti-violence strategies. And so oftentimes we go to risk reduction. And I think this is interesting. So this is the focus on like reducing risk by engaging in strategies for folks who might be potential victims. One second here. And so I think that this is, historically, this is often what colleges have done, I would say mostly, and definitely within like high school systems. What folks will do is say, well, you know, you should make sure you're not drinking too much, make sure you're not wearing something that might elicit something, you know, make sure you're moving in buddies, and that you, you know, have someone there to protect you. And now what's important to realize about the risk reduction strategy is that while some of these might be helpful, this is not focusing on the fact that we know that statistically, like around 97% of victims and survivors are sexually assaulted by someone they know and trust, right? That kind of defeats the buddy system and the rape whistle concept. Most of these assaults happen in a context where things like mace or pepper spray aren't helpful. They're happening in relationships, right? So the fact with risk reduction is it's not giving space to recognize that most perpetrators are using coercion, manipulation, and pressure and grooming that has actually been going on for quite some time. And like, come on, let's like honestly be real. Like, how many of us are like just walking around with like mace in our hands or should be blamed for an outfit that we wore? So it really has the potential to increase victim guilt and self-blame. So like, let's say I'm actually trained in self-defense and like I got myself a black belt, and I'm, you know, something happens to me by someone I know and trust, what's going to happen is I'm going to be left on that individual level of that model where I'm going to say, I should have done more. You know, I know better. I deserve this, right? So that's my two cents on risk reduction. Self-defense and empowerment is knowing your own personal boundaries. It could be about feeling good about your body, having self-confidence in expressing your desires and needs. And you know, some people really like kind of like the training, because there's, you know, there's the physical and mental aspect of kind of preparing, like almost in terms of like a safety planning. Like if someone comes from this side, I'll do this. If someone comes from that side, I'll do that. Some of the critiques from risk reduction also go down to self-defense and empowerment. It becomes the, wait, if I know how to do this, why didn't I do that? More of the buddy system. And it incorporates that sensibility around, well, the world is a scary place and it's on you to make sure you aren't messed up by it, right? And so we at the WGAC think that there is definitely maybe a form of feminist self-defense, but also recognizing that it's not just on folks to make sure that they're navigating the world being wary of perpetrators, but knowing that folks are going to be held accountable for their own actions. So we're going to move into the primary way that we engage in anti-violence here at the Women and Gender Advocacy Center, and it's called primary prevention. So the focus of primary prevention is on the potential perpetrator of harm, right? So there's this radical shift between the last slide, where it was a lot of like, what can you do? And when I say you, I'm talking about folks with minoritized identities, right? Like, so if you're experiencing multiple marginalities, it's like, make sure you're doing X, Y, and Z to keep yourself safe when the system is making sure that you're not, right? And so this one is attempts to intervene in the behaviors of potential perpetrators before a sexual assault takes place. Radical, I know. We know that these are statistics that I'm pulling from the Women and Gender Advocacy Center. So folks that are attending CSU, and I know that we're talking about teen dating violence, but the research holds pretty similar across those lines. We know that 98% of violence is committed by folks who identify as male. So we see that statistics, and we're like, okay, so that's where some of our focus is going to be. So we do have programming that is specifically targeted towards unpacking, deconstructing, dismantling hegemonic masculinity. But we also believe that everyone, regardless of gender, can benefit from primary prevention education. And so some of the ways that we do that, I wonder if that is on my next slide. Yeah, some of the ways that we do that at the WGAC is we have student involvement through peer educators. So I talked about how principals were very likely to say, you know what, I think you should go learn this at home. This is a parent thing. Which is one part of that social ecological model, right? But that interpersonal time often is spent with our peers. And so we really have seen great work come out of a peer education model. We also have a group called Men in the Movement. And so that's actually focusing on folks who identify as men and talking about relearning healthy masculinities and their role in ending gender-based violence. As I've talked about the social ecological model, I've talked about the different ways of doing anti-violence prevention, and then I landed on primary prevention. I think a fundamental concept in this work is if the larger societal framework that I talked about in the beginning is ultimately rape supportive culture, right? A culture that says, you know what? She didn't have to be in that hotel room, right? She could have told her mom that the doctor was doing something inappropriate. Those might seem like slight kind of just curiosities, but they are most definitely rape supportive culture at play, because they're focusing on the energy on doubting a person who has experienced violence rather than critiquing the system that allows violence to run rampant. And so I like to talk about offsetting that rape supportive culture by creating a culture of consent. Consent can seem like it's difficult, or it's hard. It's there's blurred lines or there's gray zones. But every time we talk about gray zones, that's honestly a part of rape supportive culture at play. I like to think of consent as ongoing. So it's a physical and emotional process between those who are able to be equally free of coercion, communicating unambiguously and sincere in their desires. So I actually talked to a group of students about the Aziz Ansari case that hit home for me. For folks who don't know, is a Tamil actor who has done a lot of work around feminism and being a comedian with a social conscience. And there was an allegation about Aziz, and a woman who is called Grace and said that was one of the worst nights of her life. Now, what's interesting is, like, I think about the fact that there was a great article critiquing this assault, and they said that, you know what, as social beings who navigate the world, oftentimes the majority of us, and let's say use men in this example, are pretty good at noticing when our boss is giving us social cues, right? Like, if we take ourselves and put ourselves in this example, it's like, I know when my boss is not really happy with, like, a report I read, right? I can feel it in their body movement. 70% of communication is in nonverbal communication. So it becomes fascinating that we are trained to navigate the social world, and most of us, right, and taking an ability into account, but that we're able, for the most part, to navigate the social world understanding these cues. And then when it comes to consent, suddenly it's like, oh, it was a gray zone, right? And so I think that is a part of the minimizing that we have done of folks who are at the back end of experiencing sexual assault as part of a patriarchal society and a society that upholds misogyny. So As we continue with consent, it's a mutual agreement to be fully present with one another throughout all interactions, to prioritize yourself and your partner or partner's needs. And it's a commitment to learning those like nonverbal cues that I just talked about, and knowing that I can change my mind at any process during or even after, right? And saying, you know what, actually that didn't feel so hot and I wasn't into it. When we work with young folks, so bringing it to teen dating violence, they're like, listen, I don't, like, movies have not shown me a way to make consent at all sexy, right? It's like, that does not sound like something I want to do, because we haven't taught it as something that's, like, socially acceptable. And so we say a couple different things. It's like, one, if, I like to say that if there isn't a moment to talk about consent, the moment doesn't sound that hot from the beginning, right? Like, I think that it doesn't sound like a good situation in the first place. Secondly, we also talk about how it doesn't have to be this thing that we're kind of scared of navigating, and understanding that we haven't been given kind of the media representation. And so we actually do a lot of activities around practicing it in everyday form, right? So not just talking about it within sexual discourse, but how can we talk about consent, bodily autonomy, right? The consent to give someone a hug, the consent to, we use a fry analogy. Can I have some of your fries, right? Can I borrow your car? So talking about consent, not just within the realm of sexual discourse. So I want us to go back to the social ecological model and take another look. I'm sorry if you're like not into models of it by now, but I'm going to kind of flip it around a little bit. And I'm going to talk about a system or rather a philosophy when dealing with primary education, primary prevention on how to deconstruct this model. So wait one second for me. I'll start again with the societal perspective. I have in here, yes means yes. There's actually a book I would recommend for any kind of educators out there. There's Yes Means Yes, Visions of Female Sexual Power and a World Without Rape by Jessica Valenti and Jacqueline Friedman. So when we are functioning from a societal perspective, what we're doing here is advocating for increased financial resources. So I'm talking about the folks that might be on this webinar. They're like, how do I fit in? I don't work one-on-one with teens. This is for folks that can create access to resources, access to occupational opportunities to actually get a counselor in a high school, in a hospital, at a community center, at a swim team, like everywhere, whose job is to talk about relationships, is to talk about reducing violence. So you're creating that infrastructure that promotes compassion, that promotes teaching folks that affirmative consent, right? If only one state in the U.S. is mandated to teach affirmative consent, there's a lot of room for us from that societal perspective to make some changes. Next, after the societal perspective, we move into institutional. Move in here. And so this is, I would say, the ways that we're doing those anti-violence strategies. So I mentioned that we use peer educator models, and we're using a survivor-centered and trauma-informed approach. That means actually giving money to the system, right? Creating policies that say, you have confidential resources, not just resources that pressure folks into using carceral systems if that doesn't feel safe for them or their communities. Mobilizing communities to take collective action and making sure that folks are being held accountable, right? We can teach and we can teach and we can teach. And then when folks are perpetrating harm and we say boys will be boys, or we say, you know what, he's actually a really great student, or they are actually really important on the football team. All of this kind of crashes down before us. Moving on to the interpersonal realm, I wrote, this is what love can look like. So that's what I had on before, actually. At the beginning, I had this is what love looks like. And so I changed it to this is what love can look like. And so showing a diversity of ways of engaging in partnership. We gotta be engaging in that radical honesty where we talk to folks and teens about different identities. We're not talking just about heterosexual relationships. We're not talking just about monogamous relationships. We're including words like poly into our lexicon, like pansexual, demisexual, queersexual, asexual. We're showing a diversity of ways to engage in healthy interpersonal styles. And that's going to be really important. I just got a question before I keep yammering on about the book title. I actually have several book titles that I think when we send this email out to folks, I'll construct like a resource guide with books. Definitely room for critique in a lot of these books, but they are good places to start. The book was Yes Means Yes, Visions of Female Sexual Power in a World Without Rape. And again, I'll list some other books at the end. All right, almost done here with the individual. I had this at the beginning too. We had, I deserve this, right? And so we get to this state where we've worked through societal, institutional, interpersonal, and personal realms to finally be like, you know what? This is what I want. I've created a list of non-negotiables in a relationship, right? Those are actual tools and skills that we've been working with young folks to say, what are my non-negotiables? What do I consider red flags in a relationship? What do I consider orange flags in a relationship? So in this individual, we can build self-efficacy to be active bystanders, to challenge misogynistic perspectives. When someone says, that's so gay, and we think that that's not related to violence, or someone calls somebody a bitch, and we think that that's not related to the suppression of women, we're not seeing this model working from all perspectives, right? So we're challenging and empowering folks to challenge those if they feel safe in that moment, and establishing positive norms, right? So we can talk at length about rape supportive culture, but it's really important to be utilizing perspectives that students are like, you know what, these are healthy forms of relationships, and actually talking about how to co-construct those together. I'm actually getting a question that's really great. It says, how do you approach parents in terms of educating these concepts? Some of them are often uncomfortable to talk about this, especially for Asian communities. That question hits totally at home for me. Like, yes, this is, you know, it's 2018 and I'm talking to you about systems of oppression and internalized dominance and oppression. But, you know, at home, that is not what we were talking about. I think that the question is, how do you approach parents? I approach parents with patience, and knowing that this will take time. So these layers that we've built up around misogyny or internalized patriarchy, they took years, decades in historical generations to build, right? So we're not going to be able to break it down within an hour session with a parent where you're like, yo, this is wrong, it's messed up, you really should learn more about anti-violence. From an anti-oppression framework. It's not going to happen in a minute. So it's about engaging folks that you have a relationship with. So honestly, I think just like I'm talking about using a peer educator model within a student approach, it's going to look kind of strange if it's just me, right? A 27-year-old woman who doesn't have children telling parents how to live their lives and how to train their children to be less oppressive. So it's actually working with parents across coalition building, right? Like, what are other parents who kind of have built up resources? How have they done this work? Engaging them peer to peer. And so I really honestly, with patience, a diversity of ways to engage, not just utilizing books. Some people are into books. Some people are into data, like I did in this presentation, right? Some people want lived experience. Some people want videos. So, all right, I'm going to see what else I have on my, it looks like we're getting actually close. I'm trying to think about before I get into like a full, as we move on, I'd ask folks to take a moment and to start thinking about questions that you would want to ask, so you can start typing those in and we can start to generate those. And I'll just kind of wrap up here as those questions come in. A few key points for today is that this work cannot be done in isolation. right? So as I talked through the different anti-violence strategies, I know that I was critiquing quite a few of them. At the end of the day, we're going to need all of them, right? We're going to need ways to talk about risk reduction that can be utilizing kind of those lenses I talked about earlier of feminist politics. We're going to need strategies that are utilizing how friends can support each other, right? Like, not particularly, we're talking about folks who have marginalized identities. We need folks with dominant identities who are their friends, who are their peers, to know that this affects them too, right? That's how privilege works. If we're not being targeted, we don't think that that enters our worldview. And so we need to talk about how we can support our friends who are experiencing multiple marginalities. I think in my summary, I talked a little bit about the particularities of working with students. I'm going to send out, I have a friend who does this work in the Bay Area, and they created a fantastic toolkit called Welcome to Building Alliances Toolkit. And because my talk was so conceptual, there's a lot of actual activities, like if you're an educator, about how do we actually talk about power and control, how do we talk about the spectrum of violence, how do we talk about safety planning, self-care, break up do's and don'ts, how to sense unhealthy relationship flags, etc. So I'm going to send that out, and that can get a little bit more into the actual doing the work, right? Not just conceptualizing the work. And I think in doing this, we have to also think about the ways that different students learn. So at the WGAC, we, in a lot of our presentations, we hand out a power and control wheel. And I think that's super helpful for young folks, because this concept of power and control is kind of like overarching, and it feels really large, and we kind of break it down into different categories, right? So power and control that's emotional, physical, using privilege, threats, coercion, manipulation. So I can send you all a resource like that that breaks down the different forms that power can be enacted. I'm getting a question here that says, how do you teach teens about the action while they feel uncomfortable after having sex, not during? Since the society might argue that the perpetrator might not even know about the victim's uncomfort, and they're not the ones who should be blamed, but the victim. Similar to my previous question, like shedding victim blaming from a society, we have a long, long way to go. Sometimes using facts can be really helpful, right? Like 98% of these are true, right? Like, we don't doubt. We use a car example. There's a similar perspective when it comes to like car theft, right? Breaking into a car. We don't really say, well, I don't think that person really broke into that car, right? So it's years of work that need to be done. But the first part of the question, how do you teach teens about the action while they feel uncomfortable after having sex? We utilize different ways of it. So sometimes it's helpful to not think about, use an example that has nothing to do with sex, because our brains and our hearts and our souls are so trained to make it be this like strange world. So how would you do that with feeling guilty about an action that's not sex, right? Let's talk about, let's say I have a friend who identifies as genderqueer, and in the classroom the professor or the teacher rather keeps using he pronouns, right? And the student doesn't really say anything. They're just like, yeah, I guess that's what they're going to say. I guess it's not that bad. By the end of the day, after hearing that all day, I could imagine that the student is now like, you know what? Actually, I wasn't okay with it. I would say that the student has every right to seek out that professor or teacher and say, you know what? I'm actually not comfortable with this, and I wasn't comfortable then. So utilizing a scenario that's not just rooted in this in the concept of sex. I'm getting a question that says, we are having a huge issue with teen dating violence in some of our schools. Is your model that uses peer educators something that would be effective in high school settings, or would it need to be tweaked for that age group? That's a great question. I think that peer educator models would definitely work in high schools. The only thing is, it's going to take a lot of infrastructure to build up, right? So it needs to be something that has resources. I will say that our students that I work with, that I supervise, they're called the Red Whistle Brigade. They are paid to do this work.
a lot of students who do this work actually often identify as survivors of some sort. So this work can be very triggering and re-traumatizing. There's a lot of self-work that goes into educating folks, and there needs to be a lot of resources to take care of those students so that their sensibility around educating others doesn't go into, you know, re-traumatizing them. Their worth needs to be placed at high value too. So I think that is a good, is a great model, but you need to know that the school is behind it, right? That there are funds to make sure that there's a coordinator who's doing that work to help their professional development, and that there are counselors on deck, etc. So, and I think that there are good models. That brings up a good question, and that I don't have the answer to you for me to be like, you know what, you should look at this high school. They have this peer education model. You should totally look into it. So I'm going to make a note to try to reach out to folks who would know of a high school that's doing this work really well, and then I can send it to the group. All right. How do you engage young adults in this conversation? I find that many call me too intense or a feminist killjoy. How do we open this conversation and teach people it's important? Well, that's a great question. I have just, you know, become okay and being proud with the feminist killjoy expression. It means that I'm awake. It means that I'm critiquing the world. It means that I'm constantly gaining consciousness around injustice. But you're right, that's not for everybody. Not everybody wants that vibe. So how do we engage young adults in this conversation? I know I've said it over and over again, but it's getting a group of people to say, you know what, we believe in bodily autonomy, we believe in consent, we think we have a carnival here every year, and it's called Consent Turns Me On. So we actually engage in this in fun ways, right? We create healthy relationship manifestos. So like, this doesn't have to be a perspective that's like cis men are creating violence and that's the only focus. That is a part of it, but also honoring self-worth, making this conversation holistic, talking about self-care. I think students do want to know that. We see really high rates of anxiety and depression students across the spectrum, right? So how can you create access points that people would want to learn about this? And so, yeah, I know it seems like a strange answer because I'm not really the one who's like, let's make it fun. But like, we have to think about students who are really hype about teaching this, right? It's not just like one kind of older educator with one identity. It's getting a group of folks with multiple identities to talk about how this is important to them. And I think that builds up the idea that like, you know what? This is something that I might care about if so many of my peers are thinking about it. I'm getting, how do we approach younger male family members that have no idea that saying something as simple as she could have said no or she could have removed herself from that situation is supporting the rape culture? I feel like I'm preaching because that is going to take some time. The model that we use here at the WGAC is to have men engage with men. So we talk about building healthier masculinities. I don't think someone's going to reach consciousness about she could have said no or she should have removed herself from that situation as supporting rape culture if they can't think about how they have experienced discrimination based on their own identity. So that's going to take a lot of time, a lot of self reflection. You really can't understand how someone who has a different identity is experiencing marginalization if you don't understand how you're experiencing some sort of marginalization in the world, right? And so once we've done that self work, creating analogies about how there's so many things in a system that keeps people from saying something. Even if we take gender out of it, right? The amount of times that power is in the room. So asking that young male student, have you ever not said something in front of a professor that you wanted, or I should say teacher, right? That you wanted to say because you felt like there would be repercussions, right? Even though the teacher never told you, you can't say this or you can't say this, right? You feared something, so you didn't leave and you didn't say anything, right? So it's creating analogies. I'm getting, maybe you addressed the high school question, but I got on the webinar late and didn't hear if this was geared for college or high school. Yeah, so I, in being honest, I work with college-age students. I talked a little bit about in the beginning that all of the students, from the data that we do, we know that folks who are experiencing interpersonal violence have experienced it at high rates before they reached 18. I think that there is this need to separate, like, right, the 17-year-old from the 18-year-old from the 16-year-old. And I don't see a lot of value from my perspective, and I know that folks might differ on those age constructs. A lot of this conversation is about systems of oppression and identity, right? And even as a 27-year-old person who holds a lot of dominant identities, I can relate with a 15-year-old because of my identity as a first-generation immigrant woman of color, right? And so the peer education model holds true, I think, from a young perspective to an older perspective. I even use the example for how do we talk to parents? Parents need to talk to parents, right? So I think some of these strategies hold true even within a high school setting. So I'm getting a question for, we have a difficult time getting into the schools to present materials to educators and youth. Do you have any suggestions to break through barriers? I think this is where my like community organizing hat comes on, because, and my human rights degree does not help, right? Because just saying this is the right thing to do has really never proved helpful. But utilizing community organizing approach would say, who are you having a difficult time getting through to, right? What is their self-interest? Is there self-interest retention? Is there self-interest graduation rates? Is there self-interest fiscal, like, you know, like making sure people are paying for things? Like, first identifying what their self-interest is and then utilizing that to get in your avenue and meet your self-interest, which is education, right? So I would, once you get specific about what the hesitations are, is actually playing the game to meet, and not just playing the, but this is the right way to do it, right? If they're data focused, if they're facts focused, we have the facts. We've had the facts, right, for centuries. So really figuring out what model they're gonna hear best. How does community engagement apply to work relating to primary prevention on schools or on campuses? This is great because the question kind of goes back to our original conversation around the model, right? So if we're only doing it from the high school lens, right? So if we're only doing it where teens are at school, you've got to think about all the other outlets that they're engaged in. Like, we're talking about sports. We're talking about theater. These are all places where we're seeing a lot of violence happen. So community engagement is like teaching, having info sessions, workshops, educators come in and talk to the people who teach the drama class after school, right? The folks that host the theater department, the art department outside of the school-related sensibilities. It's folks that will be mentors in our students' lives who, when they say seemingly insidious, small comments like, well, this hashtag MeToo movement might have gone too far. That does a lot for internalizing how young folks think about these issues. So I think getting those community workshops is key. This is interesting. How do we change the school culture regarding dress code differences between males and females? A great question is why. Why do we have this? As soon as you present that question, why do we do what we do, right? And you have a potential principal or a board that says, well, if she wears this, right, there's just so many gaps for the logic, right? When we know that the research says that it's not, that risk reduction doesn't actually prevent this, that we have to do primary prevention to hold folks accountable, because the only one that can stop rape or sexual assault is the person raping or sexually assaulting somebody. So, you know, going in with some, I guess, humility and saying, why do we have a dress code? What's the point? What's the purpose that it's seeking? And what ways is this not kind of meeting 2018 in a system that says that dividing men and women in the way that we dress is creating more boundaries? I'm getting, how can you help someone to understand the importance to make a report if they already decided not to do so? If there's a process to follow or simple respect their self-determination of not making a report. Most of the times it's because they're scared of making a report, feel shame about it, and do not see themselves as a victim. How can we help reframe feeling of guilt about the abuse? Okay, this is a great question. I'm gonna kind of use my hat as a person who works in a confidential resource center. Now, I love that you use the word self-determination, because a lot of times we think something unjust happened. I need to make sure that this gets told to the to higher reporting ends. And what's happening there is oftentimes we're centering ourselves and what we want for this person and our worldview of justice. And at the end of the day, that's taking away power, which is now just like a double, right? Because this person has already lost power through this act. And so now we're saying, well, I want this to happen, so I'm going to do this. So we really, 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 really have to do that social welfare, social work perspective of meeting them where they're at. Now, that is to say, you're right. Sometimes it's like, I don't want to make a report because that sounds like a police officer is going to show up to my ex-boyfriend's house and arrest them. Now, that's not the case. So we really need to do some education before someone shows up to our offices, scared to report, right, to the entire school and talk about what reporting looks like. Listen, if you report, this is what happens. You'll get this email, or your parents will know, or somebody, right? We need to follow through what the institution has as a reporting process so that they feel empowered to make a decision based on knowing all of the facts. And then we don't have to rush, right? So you don't have to make a report. The student, right, the person that's experiencing this harm does not have to make a report that evening, right? So how can we engage in some advocacy around how are you feeling? How has this week been for you? How are you dealing with this complex trauma or trauma? And do some work around making sure that that person doesn't feel shame. And perhaps in some time they might be like, yeah, you know what? I do want to report. And if they don't, even after all that work, we really, really, really have to honor our students' choices to engage in self-determination. Next question is, what is the most effective way for reporting sexual assault for teens when sexual assault has been in the past? 14 now, 11 was when they were assaulted. Unfortunately, I'm not the expert for the statute of limitations when it comes to outside of a college campus. I'm just gonna be honest about my limitations in answering that question. I think it depends, this is definitely state-based as well. So I think these are questions about what, you know, the state of Colorado will do or what other states would do. So unfortunately, unless someone has the answer in this group, we have 120 folks out there. If someone has an answer to what is the most effective way for reporting sexual assault for teens when sexual assault has been happened in the past, that would be great. We can pull on the collective wisdom of the group. All right, I've gone through the questions that I've seen so far. Are there any other ones that folks are interested in kind of in spending some time? We have about 5 more minutes. As you all are thinking, I will tell you about another website that I wanted to put out there. It's called scarleteen.com. That's S-C-A-R-L-E-T-E-E-N. And they do a great job of talking about consent, bodily autonomy, sexual autonomy, pleasure. So it's not just like a sex-focused perspective. That's not transphobic. Doesn't use gender binaries. It really talks about, it's hard for us to talk about consent when we might not even know our own bodies. Like, do we like hot? Do we like cold? Do we like lots of light? Like, we, particularly, I would say women and trans folks haven't been taught that those things matter, that self-discovery matters. And so it's going to be really hard to develop a sense of knowing what you want if you haven't had that time to think about it. And so I think that Scarleteen does a really good job. And so does my next resource is What You Really Want, the Smart Girls Shame-Free Guide to Sex and Safety. What I like about What You Really Want by Jacqueline Friedman is that it's a book that, yes, it's like a narrative form, but inside the book, there are these things called dive-ins, and there's all these like great activities for students to do that can be done in group work, can be done in partners, can be done by yourself, and it asks the person, like, literally, get out your notebook, write your 10 non-negotiables in a relationship. What are you looking for in a relationship, et cetera. So I would say that those kind of like toolkit-y guides can be really helpful because we can talk and talk, but if students aren't engaging that self-reflection, self-awareness, that consciousness is not gonna be built. All right, folks, we're 5 minutes out. I don't see any other questions coming through. So I might be inclined to wrap it up. I have my, let me give you all my email so you can see it's christy.kumar@colostate.edu. I have also listed the WGAC's website. There's some resources there, wgac.colostate.edu. Please reach out. Let me know if you have feedback for the presentation. It sounds like Josh is going to do his own feedback process, but if you want it to come directly to me, I welcome that feedback, suggestions, critiques, concerns. And I'll work with Josh on figuring out who wants an email from me with a list of resources, who doesn't, and how to kind of disseminate that all to you. So I guess with that, I'm done, Josh.
I'm currently passing over one question. Just give me 1 second.
Oh. Cool. Also, appreciate that over 100 people are spending their lunchtime talking about this. Shout out to all of you. I really think that that in it of itself, I'm not really great with silver linings, is a silver lining for me today. So appreciate that y'all came out for this. Okay, so I'm getting a question. It says, I work with teen girls. It is girls empowerment court ordered. There has been concern of allowing transgender youth in the group because we are girls only. How do we help girls feel more comfortable and create a safe place? Interesting. So I guess I would ask for a follow-up for the question. Is it like, how do we make sure that we keep the space a girl, like a quote-unquote girls, which I guess I'm reading as cis women space only? Or how do we kind of expand that and allow trans folks into the space? I think this is a really like burgeoning topic. And I will say here at the WGAC, we had a support group for women only. And now we have opened up the support group. And I think there's a couple of different ways to do this. I personally, this is like coming not from a research-backed data perspective, I am interested in what a gender abolitionist perspective looks like while recognizing that gender has impact, right? So we can't just say race sucks, it doesn't matter, so let's not talk about it, we're all one, right? That seems really oppressive. So the same concept applies to gender. That being said, trans folks are experiencing a similar and what we know to be greater impacts of violence. And they have been so, so systematically left out of the conversation, out of the policies of outside of survivor leadership. So I think it's really important that those lived experiences and those narratives that are based on gender oppression, right? Because what is the concept that we're talking about? We're talking about gender oppression, that they be a part of the program. So for me, I am very much an advocate of opening it up to folks who are experiencing gender-based oppression, right? And so maybe having a conversation around what does gender-based oppression mean can give some room for this conversation. And then if there are girls in the space who feel uncomfortable with trans folks, it's like, okay, well, let's do some work around identities. What's going on? Why are we feeling uncomfortable? Where is that phobia coming from, right? So it's doing work on multiple levels. All right. Okay, I think that was the last question, Josh.
Yes, it was. And thank you so much, Christy, for all of this great information. And once again, thank you all for taking your lunch hour to listen in on this webinar. And then just a tail off of your comments. Everyone will receive the follow-up email with the PowerPoint and that resource list that Christy had mentioned. So you don't need to reach out or anything like that to receive that follow-up email. It will go to everybody that had registered for this webinar. So be on the lookout for that follow-up webinar. I am currently working on scheduling 2 webinars for next month. The topics will be community engagement, and then the other one will be on crisis intervention. So just be on the lookout for those announcements as well for the registration applications. And please do fill out the survey that pops up here at the end. And is there anything else that you would like to add, Christy, before we sign off?
No, thanks everyone for taking your time to be here today.
Wonderful. Everybody have a great day. Take care.